I'm Pamela Fuselli, Executive Director at Safe Kids Canada, the National Injury Prevention Program of the Hospital for Sick Children. So our mission is fewer injuries, healthier children, a safer Canada. We really wanted to get healthier children into our mission statement because we don't want kids to not be active and healthy. We want them to do that, but we want them to do it safely. Safe Kids Canada is currently working on a number of different issues, but one of the most important ones that we're involved with right now is getting Consumer Product Safety Act passed in Canada. It's a new piece of legislation that would replace a 40-year-old piece of legislation called the Hazardous Products Act. And this would ensure that products for children, so like toys and cribs and car seats and things like that, are safer being sold in Canada. Well, with the Consumer Product Safety Act, what we hope is that the products that are sold in the Canadian marketplace, that parents can be confident that what they're buying is safe for their children to use. And if they aren't, that we have the mechanisms to get those products off the market as soon as possible. Well, right now, the federal government only has the ability to ban a product or to issue an advisory. They have to work with manufacturers and retailers to recall a product. So right now, we don't have the ability to recall products that are unsafe. We have to work with the manufacturers and retailers to get a voluntary recall. That's not the case in the United States or the European Union, which are the two other biggest marketplaces that retailers sell to. Well, right now what we see on an average year is over 14,000 injuries from product-related incidents with children under 10. So that's a huge amount of injuries. So what we're hoping with this new Consumer Product Safety Act, when it goes into place and is being enforced, that we see the numbers of injuries from consumer product goods reduced. Lots of different stakeholders are involved when we do our work. So public health units, people who have a mandate for injury prevention, but then also folks like the media who actually get the messages out, and legislators, industry, so people who are selling goods or selling products to families, we work with them, governments in terms of legislation and different policies that are in place, and that's at all levels, so national, local, provincial, and actually even internationally we work. If we've been working on it for a long time, the stakeholders have been involved right from the beginning and as we move along. So for example, with Bill C-36, which is the Consumer Product Safety Act, we had our stakeholders like the public health units and police and fire and consumer product safety groups involved right at the beginning to really figure out what would the best piece of legislation look like. And then as we've gone along with the bill, as it's gone through the legislative process, those stakeholders have been involved over and over again. The way that we work is we use a foundational kind of knowledge translation model, if you will. So we make sure that all of the messages, policies, pieces of legislation, media messages, anything like that is based on good evidence, on best practices. So we really want to make sure that if the message is getting out to parents and out to legislators, that it's the best possible message. We use a basis of evidence-based information. So whatever that evidence shows us, we then tailor the messages out. So messages for parents are going to be very action-oriented, positive, do this, not the don't do that kind of messages. For the media, it's going to be a similar kind of message to what we share with parents, but probably on a broader scope. With legislators, evidence is essential, but it's not enough. They want to know who's going to be opposing this, what the answer should be to those opposition, well, how much is it going to cost, how long is it going to take to get put in place, and if the legislation does get put in place, how will that make things different? So the message is tailored depending on the audience that we're talking to and what they really need to know. With legislation, timing is always an issue. Really, sometimes you wait a long time before it is the right time. When you have a champion, especially in the legislature, that understands the issue and can help you get it through the process of the government, which isn't necessarily easy. And unfortunately, sometimes when children are injured or killed, it brings the issue to the forefront of the media, and we're able to get the messages out that parents need to know and what legislators need to know in order to make changes positive. The challenges that Safe Kids Canada faces is always time and resources. So time in terms of the amount of time it takes to know about an issue, learn what the best practices are and be able to turn those into messages or strategies or tools to get out to parents and families. But the resources, finding the staff that have the right expertise, finding the funding to support the work that we need to do, those are all really big challenges for us. The other challenge I would say would be that most people think that accidents, which are, in our mind, injuries, are not preventable. So you often hear people talking about them as acts of fate and, you know, freak accidents and things like that. Accidents, by definition, are not preventable. But what we know is that almost 90% of injuries are predictable and therefore preventable. So one of the challenges that we have is trying to get that message out to folks that these accidents, as they know them, are actually preventable, and then how they can prevent those injuries from happening. Education is important. I mean, we do different fact sheets and checklists and, you know, growth charts to show, you know, a child at a certain age is at risk for different injuries, and so what parents can do to take precautions to reduce those kinds of injuries. But we're using more and more the social marketing, social networking kind of outreach. So Twitter, our blog on our website, YouTube, Facebook. Lessons learned, there are lots of lessons learned, but I think really what the key lesson I take from the work with SickKids Canada is that it involves so many different stakeholders, so many different people. You can't do it alone, and by building relationships with key stakeholders, with partners across the country, that there's a lot of work that can be done and success is achieved, more so than what we would achieve working alone. What would we do differently for knowledge translation? I think that really involving the key groups who are receiving these messages. I think the more we learn about how people receive their information, how they want to receive their information, how a lot of new parents and families are looking for just-in-time, customizable information for their children. So really taking that ages and stages approach. So really, you have a one-year-old who yesterday was not crawling and today is crawling. And then what does that mean in terms of injury? So now that they are mobile, they can get into different things that they could when they weren't. And so that opens them up to a lot of different injuries. So trying to share that kind of information with parents. When we start to think about our key stakeholders, we think about who has an interest in injury, who will be wanting this kind of information, or who needs to hear this information. So when we think about the public, we think about parents, caregivers, older siblings, aunts, uncles, grandparents, anyone who would be caring for children in their lives. And then when we think about professionals, the public health units, fire, police, emergency service, and then when we think about stakeholders in government, we think about the elected officials for sure, but also the bureaucrats and the civil servants who are there a lot longer sometimes than the elected officials and who know the system and who we can partner with and collaborate with. Injury prevention from a knowledge translation impact sector has been really, I think, at the forefront of integrating that knowledge translation end user service provider, if you will, into research. So a great example is the work that we've done with a CIHR grant recently around children and youth injury prevention. When the grant was being developed, the PIs got all of us involved, the end users, the researchers, to really get together over a few months and think about what really needed to be researched, what were some of the gaps that the end users, knowledge translators, were seeing, what would we like to see, and then hearing about the researchers and what their ideas for research and their interests were, and letting them know how that might be translated once the research was finished. And I think this sector does a really good job of applied research and integrating knowledge translators into the research process. We work clinically with a lot of hospitals and public health nurses. So the impact that we try to have is building their capacity. We know that their time is limited. We know that their funding is limited. So we want to make sure that if they're doing injury prevention or they're sharing injury prevention information with their clients, that they're really doing best practices so that they're, whatever activities they're doing, the public health units are doing in the communities are based on evidence and will be effective. And the same with clinical nurses and doctors in hospital kind of settings, that the messages that they're giving to parents are evidence-based and effective. Ultimately, the impact that we see from our work is a reduction in the injuries, in the deaths and hospitalizations and emergency room visits. Unfortunately, that data is about 5 years out. So we only have data right now up to 2005. So it's very hard to link specific activities to those kinds of outcomes. And so what we look at are the number of relationships that we have with folks, the number of laws that we're able to get passed, which is faster in some cases than getting real injury data. We look at the media impressions that we get. We look at the number of programs that are implemented in communities. So we look at those as sort of interim measures of our effectiveness in injury prevention. The economic impact of injuries is estimated to be in about the $4 billion mark. So injuries, preventable injuries, cost the Canadian healthcare system about $4 billion. So when we say that we know 90% of those can be prevented, you can imagine what kind of impact on the healthcare system, on the economy, on society overall, if we can prevent the majority of those injuries and actually realize the cost savings in terms of healthcare dollars, both direct and indirect. So when you think about a child being injured, not only are they injured and they're out of school, their parents are out of work, their grandparents or their neighbors or communities are impacted because they're helping the parents cope with the fact that the child is injured. My one message around injury prevention would be that they are predictable, they're preventable, there's really good evidence around what is effective, and that if we all just implemented even a fraction of what we know today, we would see a huge impact. We have some stars aligning at this point in terms of the provinces being on board, the federal government showing interest, the sector working more closely together and having grown over time. And so I think we have a real opportunity in the next 10 years to really make an impact on injury, to really get the message out there about injuries are preventable. There's ways to empower parents and ways to make healthy public policy and environments that would reduce injuries, but not impact on people's enjoyment of life overall.